We're organising research in sort of different themes, and the theme I lead, I lead it from the Vice Chancellor's office, and it's called the Global Economy, and they just prepared a new template for us just last week, so I was just excited to use it. Apart from that, there's no other reason. However, I suppose the context for a lot of what we're talking over here is very much the global economy. When I talk about global economy, I'm talking about economic development. I'm talking about economic development of, developed countries, of developing countries, etc. And many of the issues we talk about, whether it's heritage protection or disaster, often they come to clash with some of the interests in development economies. So the question from Riddhi about the story buildings. You know, the greater the economic development, the higher the story building you have, and the less wisdom we seem to have when it comes to, like, disaster prevention in this case, right? So yeah, I think we have to think about a lot of these issues in the context of the global economy. Again, in, is it Rajendra or Rajendra?
Rajendra.
So in Rajendra's talk, you mentioned again about labour. You know, one of the causes for perhaps increase as well is disruption from families and all that, but that is necessitated because we want to earn more, we want to move around, and that's all again economically connected. My point being that global economy and the issues in global economy are very good context for almost anything that we discuss, I think, today. My paper is, as you can see, entitled Comparing Mutuality and Solidarity in Its Application to Disaster Ethics. So the general area is disaster response and thinking ethically about how we respond to disasters, whether it's about preparedness for disasters or whether it's the immediate response to disasters or whether it's recovery from disasters. And within that, I want to focus on one particular behavior. So, we often hear of altruistic behavior during disasters. It could be either heroic acts or it could be small sacrifices that make a big difference during disasters. So that's the particular situation I'd like to use to sort of use that as a springboard to think about how we could embed human rights framework into disaster response. Again, at all stages, whether it is pre-disaster preparedness phase, which is literally, almost all the time. Now, for example, in London, we might be preparing ourselves, the police force as well as all different agencies, prepared for imminent this, that, and the other, whether it's terrorist attacks or it could be, who knows, something else. We also have localized storms in the UK, so it might be that, one of that. So all the stages. But the other thing I wanted to note in the context of discussing disasters is that it's very sad. We talk so much these days as disasters or about disasters. It's very possible that we are either in the age of angst, and the word disaster is used very often, or we perceive disasters to be all around us. It's become quite a common word. So whether this is a psychological state of mind or whether this is reality, the beauty of the analysis in my paper is that it brings together these states into one to discuss the ethical framework, so thereby reducing the risk on our reaction based on paranoia. So we don't have to really be bothered very much about that. Now the paper, when I wrote it, the paper is still in the context is still Europe, and it's about embedding ethical decision-making, ethical frameworks into European institutions and structures. But however, I think at its core, my analysis applies to all institutions and structures. But because many countries and regions in the world are unaccepting of human rights standards, I think there's perhaps a long way to go before taking this analysis into frameworks in, say, African or Asian countries. And in that context, I also want to note that the argument for human rights has not yet been won, particularly in Asian countries where I'm more familiar with. And also the doctrine of human rights is yet, I think, to be remodeled for Asian countries as well. And this is a huge big caveat. So therefore, I wouldn't actually recommend going down this route for Asian countries in this particular format as yet. Nevertheless, I think this philosophical framework that I would use, which I think is simple yet powerful, has probably will find resonances and probably find less objections in the Asian context than perhaps some other human rights theoretical and philosophical frameworks that have been used before. So again, as part of the background, the framework that I'm using is called the principle of generic consistency. You'd see I've not actually moved the slides because I'm still giving you the background. So I've got quite a lot of things to say, and I won't be offended if you nod off, okay? There are different ways in which people take in what I give. You can read the paper later on, because I do get monotonous in my voice sometimes. So the framework is the principle of generic consistency, PGC. Let me see actually if I gave the background. No, I didn't.
What did I?
Yes, I did, yeah. Sorry, I should be speaking with a slide. So I'm now coming down to the last part over there, okay? So the philosophical framework is the principle of generic consistency, or PGC. This is developed, or this was developed, he's no more now, by a Chicago philosopher called Alan Dewar, and this was built upon extensively by Professor Derek Delevold, with whom I studied. His method of arriving at the PGC is a dialectical method, dialectical as in dialogical. This is something perhaps more familiar for philosophy students. I'm, by the way, not trained in philosophy, but I became very interested in philosophy as I started, of course, working on my doctoral thesis now about 13, 14 years ago, long time ago. But I'm still youth, under your definition, I think. I just can't accept that age band, I have to say. dialogical method using logic. Okay, so what am I actually going to do in this paper? I mean, how is it practically applicable to disaster ethics? How is PGC practically applicable to disaster ethics? Because through this discussion, I want to discuss the obligations of three entities. One is the individual, another is the state, and another is society for disaster response. So that's the aim of taking you through some convoluted abstract stuff. Okay, so with that, last time when we had a session over here, we didn't have PowerPoint slides, so I didn't actually do it. So I just did it this morning. That's why I'm a bit disorganized with moving my slides up and down.
We caught up with technology. We caught up with technology.
I know, you've done really well. It's an amazing place at the moment. And I like this as well. Okay. I am going to read from my paper, so if you do want to stop and ask me questions, really welcome. Okay, and no question is a stupid one. Often it has been observed that in disaster situations, people, including victims, become altruistic and are very willing to listen, obey, and act in a manner that could bring about an end to the situation. Now, this observation applies differently to different people at different points in time, as in before, during, or after the tragic event. But nevertheless, there's a definite sense of solidarity, camaraderie, and altruism that can be detected amongst those that are affected, amongst those that are responding, and in some cases, those that are just onlookers. So in this piece, it is argued that this is indeed how it should be, whether disaster or otherwise, and that we have moral duties to oneself and to others. An individual exhibiting solidarity, camaraderie and altruism during a disaster is indeed behaving as a reasonable self, R capital S capital, and exercising ethical individualism, E capital and I capital, as per Gewerthian philosophy. It is the duty of the state and society to act as a supportive state, S capital, and a caring society, C capital. It's also noted that in order for the right ethical decisions to be taken in response to disasters, we must already be conditioned to do so by embedding ethical rationality in our preparedness for disaster response, both from the individual point of view as well as the institutional perspective. And also we're willing to espouse the same approach in the recovery stages. In order to be able to do this, we need to be conditioned for ethical rationality before any whiff of disaster arises. That is, in our day-to-day conduct and decision-making at the personal, institutional, and transnational level. So our ethical resilience during disasters can only be as robust as our rational, moral assurance during peacetime. This is the only reasonable expectation we can hold. Anything beyond this is a bonus. But perhaps exceptionally, some behavior during disaster situations can defy conditioning and make superhumans of us. So it's argued in this chapter that Gewerkschaft solidarity ethics should play more of a role in European policy and action in order to fulfill human rights as we seek to uphold it in Europe. Gewerkschaft's principle of generic consistency is a deontological theory and states that we have moral duties to oneself and to others. Gewerkschaft solidarity is understood as a categorical imperative, i.e. one without choice. We are to accept that humans have a duty to protect and uphold human dignity, as Derek Bailiwell says, which is foundational to action. So I argue that while there are numerous conceptions and assumptions about solidarity in official policy discourses in Europe, a notion of solidarity on which European view of solidarity needs to be built has to rely on a much stronger conception of solidarity as laid out by Gewer and Bailiwell. If we are to ensure that it is in keeping with our obligations under human rights law. So this, I would say, is a key point of this paper. We need to be able to make sure that we are complying, which is a very minimum. We are upholding human rights law, at the same time responding to disaster as we should be. Upholding that principle of solidarity that we say, but then we could have a weak conception of solidarity and we could have a strong conception of solidarity. What I'm arguing for here in this paper is talking about what exactly is the strong conception of solidarity. And for that, I talk about human rights, not in an individualistic or atomistic manner. I talk about human rights as much more as what is called a community of rights, okay, which in many ways is antagonistic to certain ways of conceiving human rights as being very individualistic, as being very centered on one individual. Okay, so while the applicability of human rights law in the aftermath of disasters has not been so widely examined by regional or international human rights bodies, it is justified to assume that human rights protection is still integral to disaster response. I don't think we can deny that. I don't think we can say, well, human rights can be set aside for some situations of society, and then for others we can bring it in. No. You either have human rights and uphold it, or you don't. Mutuality in Gewerkschaft ethics is not reciprocal. This is one big feature. Often in European documents you find there is an understanding of reciprocity in solidarity, whereas in Gewerkschaft ethics, so in Gewerkschaft solidarity ethics, that's not the case, and that's the key difference. And what is it based on? It's based on basic needs and works hand in hand with a caring society and a supportive state. So the interconnectedness of the reasonable self, exercising the ethical individualism in a caring society and a supportive state is the key to ethical human rights proof disaster response. So moral structures built around this idea of mutuality, when human rights is actually a community of rights, and where there is a deep concern about freedom and well-being of all members of society. So you might have the question, well, if we are talking about human rights as a community of rights, what about the freedom of every individual? Yeah? The Gewerkschaft ethics finds a way of saying, well, the freedom of every individual is still very much preserved in the way it should be. Research tells us in terms of the prevalence of altruism and solidarity in disaster situations. So widespread altruistic behavior is observed in survivors of disasters, as well as online, as well as in situ. Now this has been described as by Griswold in 2013 as the compulsion to help. When after the 9/11 attacks, people felt the overpowering sense to volunteer. So it was a study conducted soon after the 9/11 attacks. Crowds have been observed as being benevolent during emergencies. This is a study from Drury, Cocking and Reich in 2009. Recent research even argues for an altruistic brain. Don't ask me what that is, I haven't actually read it. In a study that looked into the likely responses by different groups to a bioterrorist attack, it was found that officials could expect deviant behavior, can't rule it out, but individual citizens would mostly behave altruistically and rationally. That is the Fisher study in 2000. Solidarity is exhibited in groups and communities in various ways. The early reports that came out of the terrorist bombings in a Belgian airport, an underground transport system in March 2016, recounts acts of altruism of victims towards other victims and of those who were not injured towards those affected by the incidents. In 2007, during the London bombings, researchers have found high levels of mutual aid among survivors and witnesses of the bombings. Now, selfishness was more common during the daily rush hour on the tube than during the London bombings on the tube. It was a telling observation to the decentralization of individuals on a day-to-day basis. Yeah? So on the tube, no. Don't even know what the next person is actually doing, because whereas completely flips when it came to, you know, the London bombing. That was what the 2009 study showed. Following the November 2015 terrorist shootings in Paris, companies such as Google pitched in by making their internet call service free of charge for a certain period. The altruistic behavior of people in donating blood following the Madrid terrorist bombings in 2004, although not needed for such incidents, was nevertheless in response to such an urge to help. Altruism as a hindrance rather than a help is not uncommon in disaster situations. Yeah. And points to the duty that exists in members of society to take informed decisions about actions. So this is another point that the working framework addresses as well. It's not enough if you just rush in and do things. It's not enough if we often, I think you might have, as you mentioned there, you know, passing on fake information or fake news. There is a obligation not to actually do that. Similarly, you know, not to go and probably be more of an annoyance and a hindrance by saying, well, can I help, without really informing yourself. So the, you know, thing about training is crucial. So altruism as a hindrance rather than a help is not uncommon in disaster situations and points to the duty that existing members of society take informed decisions about actions. And converting self-interested rational agents in the exercise of moderate altruism, and does not discount the duty to inform oneself. Okay. So as I said, the Gilbertian framework has a time and a place for how the self-interested rational agent should be behaving. In the aftermath of the chemical gas attack in Halabja in northern Iraq in 1988, in the absence of any institutional response, the people of the town buried the dead, demonstrating the poignancy of altruism when their own government ordered the disaster. I know this is highly politically charged, but this is coming out of research which makes up presumptions. During the Tokyo sarin gas attack by the group Om Shinrikyo in 1995, the lack of obvious signs as to the nature of the attack meant that the victims and the first responders were travelers. Reports of callous behavior of passengers towards passengers and discomfort on trains in Tokyo could be explained by the fact that there was no obvious sign of an attack. Murakami, in his book that recounts interviews of victims and responders, talks about passengers wanting to distance themselves from the situation by changing trains. Perhaps this behavior is the cusp of the daily commuter syndrome of indifference and the altruistic individual behavior during an obvious disaster. So that's an interesting point as well. You know, when is a disaster an obvious disaster, and how that brings out the altruism? When the disaster is not an obvious disaster, like it happened in this gas attack, you couldn't actually see what was happening, but people, it was just discomfort. So people said, like, you know, you have a corpse, I'm going to move away from you, sort of thing. So that is a very difficult situation in terms of how should we behave ethically, right? And then it goes to the heart, or the core of informing ourselves. And then almost, you know, you start thinking, okay, day in and day out, I should be informing myself about every possible risk that's there, if that's our full-time job, you know. How are we going to... It's just a huge task, and that's why we've got to be very careful about how we prepare ourselves, what we should prepare for, because we don't have much time to spend on all of that. Okay, so policies that respond to disasters in Europe take into account these behaviours and accommodate and indeed count on altruism and solidarity. So I would say, you know, full marks in a way for some of the European policy which allows people to give vent to the altruism in a very structured, organised way. Various initiatives such as EU aid volunteers provide, I think they've got another slide on that. Okay, there we go. So various initiatives such as EU aid volunteers provide outlets for such altruism in a structured way. In the 2009 CBRN plan adopted by the EU Commission, the principle of solidarity exists as a top-level principle. States have the responsibility primarily in protecting against CBRN threats, but EU initiatives are guided by the EU solidarity principle. Article 222 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, EU, incorporates a spirit of solidarity in order to bring together the resources of European states to respond to disasters and is being infused into the CBRN action plan. But of course, we all know that, you know, the spirit of coming together in solidarity and forming a union now is, especially post Brexit, UK, is shaky. At least, well, it's just a question whether it's shaky or perhaps we've become even more aware that we need to be together. You know, at least certainly in some of the academic circles, Brexit is seen as a huge disaster. In the US, the 2006 National Strategy for Combating Terrorism highlights the need to develop a culture of preparedness. And I say this with a lot of wariness at this point in time. It seems to assume solidarity as integral to this culture. Okay. Doesn't really make well for the discussion, very brief discussion we had this morning about who's being excluded from the US. But this was the 2006 strategy for combating terrorism. So solidarity among niche groups as a result of tragedy can also be potent in the context of disaster relief and prevention. Now at the very last section of that slide. The notion of modern altruism is stretched to its limit to accept and support such groups, and such acceptance should be based on self-interested rationality, i.e. as a necessity at the very minimum. So Families Against Terrorism and Extremism, FATE, talks of the resilience as a way out of pain, shame and guilt of a loved one who has been involved in terrorist activities by helping prevent others from getting involved. So this is the other side. Those who've been responsible for perpetrating the disaster, how do the families come together? Is there an element of solidarity in that? And then how do they reach out to the rest of the society to form solidarity? And what are our obligations as a Gewerthian rational agent, a reasonable self? How do we accommodate them? So this whole idea about forgiveness or whole idea of accepting those who we see as the cause of the disaster is again a very difficult issue to address, but one that can be addressed. The notion of moderate altruism, but I believe it really does stretch the limits of the exercise of moderate altruism. Similarly, Network of Associations for Victims of Terrorism, NAVT, has one of its aims to promote solidarity with victims of terrorism and better citizenry. The Common Bond Project promotes solidarity among young people who are victims of terrorism in particular. Okay, I think I'll pause at this point to ask if I continue in the same pace and give you the same content, or should I be more briefer? Or
that's an interesting review, I think. But one of the points you raised is the visibility of, if we can see people need help, we may help them. But if we can't see people need help, we may just ignore them.
Yeah.
And this is not only in times of, you talked about the sarin gas attack, or in terms of also a disease.
Yeah.
Often the mentally handicapped people, they are unable to, people can't see them as,
yeah.
Or illiterate people, for example. You look like you should speak English or Japanese or Chinese or
yeah.
Hindi, but you do not. So people think that you're rude because you don't reply to them. And people with many challenges. So altruism, the boundaries, mean we need to identify you to a group who should be deserving of altruism rather than just being a being who should receive altruism anyway.
Yeah, yeah. I suppose it's a question in terms of the even drawing a boundary.
Yeah.
In a way, as moral agents,
yeah.
The boundary would be more based on the factors in the now, as opposed to a categorization that you could hold forever.
yeah.
in a way. So what I'm saying, I think, is that there's no boundary. There's no boundary for me.
Or still, for example, if I have to choose between you and your laptop, I may help you, but maybe you can survive, so maybe I should really help the laptop. I don't know.
Ah, okay. So what you're talking about where is the obligation? Yeah, it's the balancing of the moral duties and obligations.
Yes.
Which in itself is a moral duty.
Yeah.
That you've got to do that because, yeah. Well, I suppose that's the boundary there is our finiteness in a way, isn't it?
I have a comment.
Yes, go ahead, Anke.
Yeah, when you see the film Hotel Rwanda, you find UN people only helping UN staff, but not their local wives, for example, spouses. So there is another extreme altruism whereby restricted officers, UN people are restricted, they are not allowed to carry other people who are not authorized in their car and so on. Mm-hmm. So someone can be altruistic by helping a person in need and break an institutional rule and therefore may risk to be fired. But in some cases, you rather lose the job, but you have helped the person and you're also morally and ethically sound. Because if you don't do it, you may feel haunted that I killed someone because I followed my rule of my employer. So sometimes you, while you're helping, you're actually having also a loss to account for things.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. In the framework I discuss, I talk about a supportive state, and I think UN as an institution would come close to that. But I have to say, I haven't thought very much about you know, United Nations within that framework, because the context of this is because the cooperation between states in Europe is much higher, if you like, than the cooperation between states in the that form the members of the United Nations organization. So in a way, there's you can speak together in one voice, but I suppose the same situation would arise if there were something similar to UN peacekeepers, like EU.
Well, there are, for example, in Africa, the African Union soldiers, but I give another example of emergency help. If we're going to be hearing about gunshots this afternoon, okay, but if somebody actually, you see them with a gunshot to their chest right now, the most altruistic thing you can do is put them in your car and rush at high speed to the hospital. Even more than, you cannot wait to ring your ambulance. And that's why in many police departments in the United States, the policemen, what people are doing is, that's their code, they've written it, is basically if they see a person with a gunshot, they don't wait for the ambulance, they put them in the car and rush to the hospital before they bleed out. And this is the most altruistic thing you can do.
Yeah.
And so it's, anyway, hopefully that doesn't happen, but we will hear about some of these sad issues this afternoon. But so maybe you please continue, Chamu, your
question.
And there was also a request for the full paper eventually, so you'll publish the full paper. We can send it to you.
Yeah,
I'll
say, what's happening? Principle of generic consistency. These are concepts that are that arise from that framework. So the different converging concepts of reasonable self, ethical individualism, supportive state and caring society referred to earlier will be discussed in this section to analyse altruistic conduct as rational ethical conduct and solidarity as ethical individualism. The scope of solidarity is discussed under the notion of moderate altruism. Alan Gilbert, a Chicago philosopher and a neo-Kantian, has elaborated the PGC theory, which supports the self-chosen purpose of an individual, and in order for it to be achieved, states that the individual, who is generalized as an agent, someone who can do something, has what's called generic needs. So the rights to the generic needs are known as generic rights. Now, it would not be rationally possible to deny these rights for oneself as an agent or for any other who displays the characteristics of an agent as discussed above. That is the self-chosen purpose. So freedom and well-being are seen as the generic needs in order for the agent to be able to act at all. So Gilbert uses a dialectically necessary method to arrive at the notion of generic needs. So if A is an agent, i.e. wanting to act for a voluntarily chosen purpose, then A should accept to themselves, hence the dialectical method, that they value the purpose so as to aspire to achieve that purpose. So in this way, by combining the dialectic method with logic, Gilbert arrives at the position that what is true for oneself as an agent, that is the need for having generic rights, is also true for all other agents. Hence, a logical link is created with other agents, starting from oneself as an agent. A dialectically contingent argument can be made in order to show that a framework of human rights is predicated on the basis of generic rights. So this will be picked up in the next section when I'll be discussing the state and society as a supportive state and a caring society. So for now in this section, we're just looking at the moral agent and the moral agent in dialectic logic. So, Alan Gilbert arrives at the notion of productive agency, generic needs, and generic rights purely logically, using a dialectically necessary method, which he calls the principle of generic consistency. Now, the statement as he puts it, or the statement of generic consistency as he puts it, is as follows. A person is generically inconsistent, or inconsistent in a fundamental way, if while exercising his own capabilities of agency, he rejects, either in thought or in action, the possession or exercise of those capacities on the part of other persons. Now, the notion of a reasonable self is perspectival. From the point of view of a community, the generically consistent individual described above in the PGC statement as a reasonable self is the agent who is very different to what would be a Hobbesian self, which is much more atomistic in the individualism. Now, a Hobbesian self would be generically inconsistent and would not be exercising ethical individualism. Now, the reasonable self recognizes that there is a rational basis for treating others' needs as having some bearing on the fulfillment of one's own needs as well. So, because the contributions made to an individual by society, the individual to an extent is a social product, or individuals are social products. So this is Gilbert's social contribution theory. So an individual then recognizes that they have an obligation towards society because of society's contribution to their agency. And their agency is what they have chosen for themselves to be able to do. Right? So ethical individualism is therefore egoistic in that all persons that help to develop their abilities of agency is regarded by each individual simply as the price she must pay to fulfill these personal needs for herself. But the society should be structured institutionally that it promotes equal rights and mutuality in order to be able to become a society which recognizes the social contribution thesis. So the outline of Gilbertian solidarity ethics has been laid out above through the concepts of reasonable self, social contribution thesis, and ethical individualism. So to fully understand how the reasonable self behaves and the basis for GSE, Gilbertian solidarity ethics, one must turn to the notion of mutuality. At this point, links are made to the political project of human rights, whereby historically there exist different generations of human rights within the philosophical understanding that human rights are indivisible. Therefore, civil, political, social, economic, and cultural rights are one, but different in name. In GSE, there is no need to make a reference to these differences. But from the political and legal point of view, this is essential for understanding of how GSE can have true harmonizing effect on a broad and year-round disaster ethics, European disaster ethics policy. So the artificial division between positive, i.e. socio-economic cultural rights, and negative, i.e. civil and political rights, is a barrier in fully realizing solidarity as a policy goal in Europe. Now, Gilbert lays out the hierarchy of needs. So he talks about basic needs, which leads to the generic rights. And then there's other levels of needs, which then trump each other off. So basic, non-subtractive, and additive goods. However, these, in a way, are a mix of first generation, second and third generation human rights that do not nicely fit the categorizations that is adopted in Gewerth solidarity ethics. So then the message from solidarity ethics, Gewerth solidarity ethics, to our conceptualization of a European disaster policy based on human rights framework that separates economic, social, cultural, political, and civil rights is to reorder that, rejig them with respect to how social contribution pieces works. Okay? So in a way, the hierarchy we have, which is civil and political rights first, economic, social, cultural rights next, will be broken, but not in the ways that we might imagine it. So for example, cultural rights could take precedence in some cases. Okay? So the core innovation, if you like, that Gewerthian principle of generic consistency contributes to solidarity discussion is the concept of mutuality. So that's what I'm going to look at in the next. I think that's where my slides actually finish and stop. Mutuality as the nature of positive rights. I'm just going to look and recalibrate how much time I've got.
5 minutes.
Yeah. I might actually just skip this whole section, although that's the title of my paper as such. I'm sorry about that, but you know, leave you to read that. Mainly because I think it's much better read, you know, than me just speaking it out right now, especially because I'm reading it out of a paper. So I'll just go to that last section about, you know, what is the supportive state and caring society? Because that sort of completes the whole picture from the individual level to the state level, but more broadly society as well. Okay, Gewerthian actors exhibiting solidarity, camaraderie, and altruism during disaster indeed behaving as moral and rational agents, and their impact depends on institutional frameworks as well as their own effort. But it is a duty of the state, and this is where we introduce what is the duty of the state in the Gewerthian solidarity ethics concept. It is the duty of the state to shape itself around such a reasonable self. Yeah? It is the duty of the state to shape itself around the reasonable self, to protect and promote the reasonable self, ever present to reinforce this idea of the development of responsive institutions. Yeah. So this sort of then comes back to the point that Darrow was making, which is, you know, how the legal frameworks may enable or may not enable certain responses from individuals in situations. Okay, so responsive institutions, but that, I mean, I've been distracted by the point mainly because, you know, as a lawyer I have to talk. That point is very interesting, which is looking at law in the black and white and looking at law more as liability, looking at law more as not an enabler. And that's a whole, you know, important point, I think, to be made. And I have to say that some of the objections that come from that angle are slightly removed from the analysis that I'm making, which is about the ethical framework that also has to form the basis of the law as well. So I would be critical of the law on the basis of that framework we're discussing here. Okay, the state and the society needs to provide the scaffolding by being a supportive state in the caring society in order to increase the chances that all agents are fulfilled in their human rights as much of the time as possible, and that includes during disasters as well. Okay. So within this sentence, I've sort of rolled in what is the state's, if you like, peacetime, if you think about disaster and war, if you make that analogy, the state during peacetime and how human rights should be fulfilled is very much similar in terms of the ethical obligations to what you have in disasters. Okay? And because of the gaps we have in how we do ordinary governance, if you can use that term for peacetime governance, that is also reflected in disaster situations. So in a way, we should really be surprised when things fail the way they do, and especially in that example I gave about Kalabja and how the state was doing, in fact, firstly it perpetrated the thing and then it didn't really affect anything at all. So, now being a supportive state means that it has a human rights framework that it supports, okay? It's a start, and again, this is quite specific to Europe, the context, so I did mention that. Duties and obligations of the state arise from generic rights that are embedded in policy as human rights. Human rights are essentially ethical, they're non-territorial. A supportive state has an obligation to develop positive rights as well as negative rights. I'll go a little bit into detail about what that might be. In discussing the indirect application of PGC, Gilbert requires the transition from a minimal state to a supportive state. So he starts now looking at... So, when Gilbert, quite unlike some of the philosophers, Gilbert actually does some social science research. So he actually goes on sites, he's spent some time in Spain, looking at how communities govern themselves, etc. And he's, so some of his observations about states come from direct observations, in states, as opposed to your very doctrinal, top-down, inductive approach. So he does have a deductive approach as well. So from that, he sort of conceptualizes states to be on like a spectrum. One, you could be a minimal state. The other, you could be a supportive state. And it's that journey, you get closer to fulfilling the birth in solidarity and being a supportive state as you move from the minimal state to the supportive state. Supportive state should give more of a role for the crowd to render help during emergencies. This is something that's been supported by a piece of research, social science research. One of the recommendations, like you were making recommendations, it also mentioned that. So that the institutional structure that harbors the birth and age and supports mutualism and not egoism. Gilbert points out that the distribution of political power is a decisive factor, and hence the responsibility in institutional rather than the individual, because the distribution of power affects how individual can exercise their responsible, reasonable self. Again, coming back to the example that Arrow gave. And then there's some bits about how the Human Rights Advisory Committee of the United Nations General Assembly in its 2015 report talks about mainstreaming human rights into disaster responses, which I think was, to a certain extent, is talks the converted, and for the others, it doesn't do very much. So we need to move from, just speaking to the converted to be able to look at how human rights can be mainstreamed in different ways, which means that even conceptualizing human rights differently. Okay, there's a lot more in there, but let me see if I can get to the conclusion. So, conclusion. Construing solidarity as Gilbertian mutuality in disaster ethics creates a rational human rights framework that operates as a community of rights. It provides a worthy framework during a difficult situation where moral decisions are taken within a structure already made conducive to human rights and human dignity. Mutuality is a key human rights concept manifesting in the recognition and promotion of positive human rights law in a supportive state, and provides continuity between resilience and disaster paradigms. The role of communities in disaster relief and resilience is often ignored or only grudgingly tolerated. However, the birth in solidarity ethics places the community in an integral position for the fulfillment of human rights. So this piece then sought to reconcile altruistic behavior with a human rights framework that recognizes and builds upon this phenomenon. A very short conclusion. So I hope you actually took something away from it. Thank you.
Stay there. So we have a thank you, Chamu, chance for questions and discussion. Any comments or questions?
Yeah, it's a very good philosophical paper. Congratulations for that. Just one clarification. It mentioned in one of the slides about the self and as a self purpose choosing what self.
Oh, yeah.
So it's about in the context of the freedom and the self, something like that.
Yeah.
So, I just thought.
Yeah, it's one of those slides, yeah.
Yeah, self-chosen purpose of an individual.
Yeah.
So that self-chosen purpose of an individual during that time of disaster, how could you rate it as the reasonable or how rational the self-chosen behavior, purpose of an individual should be? How do you define the self-chosen purpose of an individual as rational or reasonable during the time of disaster? Or maybe how do you balance the reasonableness of the state and that of the individual during the time of disaster?
Yeah, okay. That's I think like the two different things. So in this case, the self-chosen purpose is literally the notion of acting. Okay. So so an agent is someone who acts, and they act in order to fulfill a purpose. Okay. And then in a disaster situation, they, so that the act itself would be their action to get involved, or their decision to get involved. And then the chosen purpose would be how they respond. See what I mean? Okay? So I wouldn't apply the self-chosen purpose. I wouldn't say that the self-chosen purpose over here relates to that level of choosing what action to do. Or making the choice between, you know, either pulling someone out or searching for more people who might, you know, be in the last stage of their life. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
So you can't. Yeah, you can't. That will come at the stage of, you know, the choice they make by this. You know, so they choose not to be a rational ethical self, and then they make the choice, and that would be more of a factual decision that they make. Okay, so the idea is that the decision that they take will be the right decision because they're acting as the reasonable self and because they're within the framework of a caring society and a supportive state. Right. So monitoring the choice of individuals during disaster situations using PGC is not what I've developed yet, and I'm not. Yeah, I something about. How, you know, how useful it might be or how suitable for a person is not something I've thought of. Am I making myself clear in terms of how...
Any other comments or questions? Okay. Okay, well, thank you very much, Chamu.
Thank you.